Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I hope you're all doing well, inshallah. So, inshallah, for this week's video, we're going to be asking or answering a very controversial question. And that question is, does Islam need feminism? Now, for that, I have a special guest, Brother Muhammad Hijab, who'll be helping us with this question and giving us some insight on Islam's view on this, and also talking a little bit about maybe modern day feminism, try to weigh the two out and we can kind of see a clear picture, inshallah. So please don't go anywhere, you don't want to miss out.
كتاب الله دستوري وخير الخلق أسوتنا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So أخونا محمد, يعني, how would you start about talking about this topic, feminism and Islam? يعني, many people around the world, they truly believe that Islam oppresses women and that Islam completely disregards women's rights. And that they think that feminism or modern day feminism is the answer that they are looking for, that this is the solution that the world needs. Yani, obviously, as a Muslim, I like to think otherwise. Yani, where would you go about this?
I think with this kind of discussion, there are usually a lot of hidden presuppositions and assumptions which we need to unpack. Of them is that Islam in and of itself is in need of anything. So we would say that Islam is a system, a religion, obviously, which we believe was revealed from God.
Yeah.
The all-powerful, the all-knowing, the all-wise, and which has laws that are put in place and injunctions and prescriptions which are meant for all peoples in all times. And within this system of Islam, there is an inbuilt flexibility, if you like, which is like the usul of Islam, which are usul al-fiqh, you can call it, which is a kind of, in certain circumstances, some of the rules will vary. Yeah, now these are all things which are known to people of Islamic law and jurisprudence and these things. So that's Islam. Feminism is basically a term used for what can be sometimes referred to as a political philosophy, but more commonly referred to as an ideology, which spanned, you know, a good amount of time. Some people start it off at 1780. With the Vindication of Women's Rights, written by Mary Wollstonecraft in the later kind of Enlightenment period, or in the Enlightenment period, more like, and up until kind of what you refer to as third wave feminism, or some have dubbed as third wave feminism. So this is the breadth of the, if you like, scholastic tradition, the feministic scholastic tradition. Some say, no, well, this is, you're starting with the Vindication of Women's Rights, where there was things that were written before and things that were done before, and I would agree with that as well. I mean, that wouldn't be referred to as feminism in the modern sense. Even Wollstonecraft herself is referred to as a pseudo-feminist, and she wouldn't be in line with, say, second or third, definitely not third wave feminists of today. So feminism is different depending on what time we're looking at, what time period we're looking at. First wave feminism is not necessarily something which we, which is in contradiction with Islam, frankly, because a lot of the things that were kind of elaborated upon by people who kind of advocated the rights of women and what you refer to as universal suffrage or women's suffrage wasn't in disagreement with Islam. I mean, Islam at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was obviously alive, and after him, with the Sahaba that became the leaders. We don't have a system which can be described, if we're being totally ingenuous here, as democratic in the Western sense. But we do have a system which is which has an element of social contract, which is kind of like also in line with liberal theory. So it's called bay'ah, which is like a pledge of allegiance that that people would give to an elected individual,
yeah,
who's elected by, we can say, the Ahlul Hali wal Aqd, which is a different conversation, like people of particular status and people with particular abilities in the society. After that, though, bay'ah is taken out. Bay'ah is the social contract. It's almost completely equivalent to the social contract that was described by Thomas Hobbes and the Leviathan and even Rousseau in his book, The Social Contract. Now, what the social contract entails is basically that there would be representation by the government. In this case, it would be the Khalifa, the representative, on behalf of his people. So in the case of the Khulafa al-Rashideen, they had this bay'ah in place, and it was men and women who would give the bay'ah. And this was 1,400 years ago. Obviously, in ancient Greece, where democracy first was initiated, according to the majority of historians, there wasn't that equal representation, and women were not counted as part of the electorate, and neither were children or slaves. And moving fast forwarding up until 1915 in Canada, because in 1916, I think, is when female suffrage was put into place. In England, it was 1918 for women that were older than 18, and then 1928 for women that, women that older than 30, and then 1928 for women that older than 18. So if we fast forward up until that point, the Islamic system allowed representation or bay'ah, where pledge of allegiance to take place with both men and women, 1,400 years, so it predated the feminist movement. So, and it allowed the same kind of representation between men and women in the political system, if you like. So, and it even predated any Western kind of, I'm not going to generalize completely because I haven't looked at all the crevices of history, but most Western civilizations. I mean, I don't know of any that particularly come to mind where women were represented in that equal way on a political level. So, first wave feminism is, I would say, largely in contradistinction with the hadith and the Quran and stuff like that. It's not in complete contradiction in its sentiment. Obviously, we don't have a problem with the claims here. That, I mean, one of the things I did once, looking at the primary sources of the parliamentary record, because they had debates in Parliament in the UK, and some of the debates they had was arguments for and against feminism. Arguments for and against women having to vote and things like that. And it was usually the liberals and the it was the liberals at the time, not the Labour Party. The liberals and the liberals who would be pro, and obviously the conservatives largely that would be against the idea of women. And the arguments put forward were really interesting in a way, but we wouldn't necessarily agree with those arguments that are put forward by the conservatives. And if you look at their reasoning, it's kind of like a lot of it is not justified. Yeah. A lot of the reason why there was a shift or a paradigm shift even in the body politic in the UK and otherwise. And by the way, it's really interesting here seeing the way in which all the Western countries kind of copied each other, because you had Canada, I think 1916 or something like that. America, I think it was something 1917, or then England, or UK, 1918, something like this. Like, this was when they all kind of agreed.
Yeah.
But it all happened to World War One, or around the time of World War One, which was a time where women were needed to. So in other words, women were needed to be a part of the body politic, or they were needed to be a part of the sociological environment as a helping hand, because they were going to factories and building all kinds of things and doing all kinds of things that men were no longer able to do. So with that came, okay, well, you can do this, you can also do this, right? But it took a long time for them to come to that conclusion, and a great war. In fact, one of the greatest wars of human history, you know, for them to even come to the conclusion that Islam had already come to 1,400 years ago. You see, so it's kind of ironic that they come back to us and say, well, you know, you're against feminism and you're against these things. Because looking at the first wave feministic movement, look what you had to go through in order to give women a vote, right? And then, you know, the suffragette movement and the suffragists and all these things, and people committing suicide, you know, these and all kinds of violent acts happening in order for women to get the vote at the end of it. And we don't know what really tilted over, but according to me, I would say that it's probably the war effort.
Yeah.
So having said that, first wave feminism is not really it's more in contradistinction in its sentiments with the Islamic discourse. Second wave feminism is where we start to see problems,